Welcome. So my name is Shreya Chatterjee, and I'm head of research and learning at the Paul Mellon Center. And so this is the first session of our summer research seminar series, and it's called Liquid Crystal Concrete, the Arts in Postwar Britain. We have some housekeeping to do before I sort of go into details about today's program. I'm going to wear a mask, so just tell me if you hear me all right. Fine? Good. So fire safety stuff. There are no fire drills scheduled for the duration of this event, so if the fire alarm sounds, please leave your belongings behind and calmly begin to evacuate the building. Your nearest fire exits are on the ground floor through either front doors of the center. Please assemble outside 28 Bedford Square, which is to the right as you leave the building, and don't leave the area or attempt to return to the center until you've been advised it's safe to do so by a member of PMC staff. That's all for fire safety stuff. To think a little bit about why we're all here, this series was put together really to think together about the arts of post-war Britain as an interdisciplinary and also transcultural terrain of research. And over the next few weeks, you're all really welcome to join for the other talks. You'll hear from scholars who engage with the intersections of art, technology, and new media, the environment, issues of empire and world making, and also questions of migration. This evening's session, as you know, is on British cybernetic art. And I'm so delighted to welcome Catherine Mason and Ernest Edmonds to the Paul Mellon Center. So the first part of the evening, Catherine will deliver a talk titled British Cybernetic Art, The Origins of Digital Art, which provides a look at the more than 50-year history behind contemporary digital art, thinking primarily about cybernetics and its relationship to art schools in Britain. As a way of introduction, Catherine Mason is an independent art historian. She writes about historic and contemporary digital art, art schools, and the history of computer arts, early British computer animation, among many other things. So after her talk, Catherine will be in conversation with Professor Ernest Edmonds, who is an artist who pioneered the field of computational art from the 1960s when he taught at Leicester Polytechnic. His books include The Art of Interaction and From Fingers to Digits, An Artificial Aesthetic, which was co-written with Margaret Bowden. So we'll have two parts to this evening, and they follow on kind of directly from one another. And after that, we'll have time for questions, quite a lot of time for questions, and then we have a reception just round next door. We're really excited to have Catherine and Edmund here with us tonight at the Paul Mellon Center in person, and also to see all of you here in person and lots of you joining online. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Catherine.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Sriya.
I'm very pleased to be here. So today we're going to, this evening we're going to take a look at how artists came to use computers and digital information technologies in their art. Well, the answer lies at least partly in the post-war science of cybernetics and its strong link with British art schools. So we're going to see tonight is a particularly British interpretation of art informed by systems and technology, which eventually became more focused in the late 1960s and into the 70s, particularly in art schools. Now, this is a huge field. So in the short space of time I have tonight, we're just going to actually have a general introduction, and I hope to hit some of the highlights to give you an idea of the wealth of activity that took place during this period and some of the reasons behind it. Well, in the immediate post-war period, there were no computers available to artists, but there was a great wealth of conceptual thinking. And this was inspired by the science of cybernetics, which influenced subsequent generations. And a computational way of thinking about art production began to take shape. Now, as we'll see throughout this session, this concept had a profound impact on artists by giving them a framework within which they could consider new technologies. And much of this work was experimental and collaborative in nature, And in fact, it's this collaborative aspect that comes to define the early days of computer arts activities in Britain. So the new scientific development of cybernetics was to inform the gestation of computer arts. But what is cybernetics? Well, it's originally a Greek term, kubernates, which meant pilot or steersman. And cybernetics as a term was first used by Plato in his dialogues to denote a governor of a country. But the discipline of cybernetics in the modern sense was coined by a mathematician at MIT in the late 1940s, Norbert Wiener. And his seminal book of 1948, Cybernetics or Control and Communication in the Animal and the Machine, was extremely influential. Now, according to Wiener, at a basic level, cybernetics refers to the set of problems centered about communication, control, and statistical mechanics, whether in the machine or in living tissue. Now, this includes the communication within an observer and between the observer and their environment. So I'm going to summarize here greatly, but the basic concept of cybernetics is that the behavior of all organisms, machines, and other physical systems is controlled by their communication structures, both within themselves and within their environment. So the idea of control and communication, as you can see here, is at the root of cybernetics. And self-regulation by feedback is found in all cybernetic systems and processes, whether natural, mechanical, or social. So now, with this new field of cybernetics, different disciplines could have a shared vocabulary. And it could also apply to many different fields. On both sides of the Atlantic, the potential that cybernetics held for creating improvements in complex systems was quickly recognized. And Wiener's book was hugely far-reaching, and these notions of control, feedback, and communication penetrated almost every aspect of technical culture. Now, in the UK, it was the most intellectually powerful and influential cybernetics group was the Ratio Club, which started out in Cambridge in 1949. And this included outstanding psychiatrists, neurologists, mathematicians, engineers, and others who met to discuss issues such as new ways of thinking about behavior-generating mechanisms and information processing in brains and machines. And the members included, you can see them here, Alan Turing, who's down there on the lower left. Of course, Alan Turing, universally regarded as one of the founding fathers of computer science and artificial intelligence. At this time, he was working on one of the world's first stored program computers in Manchester. Also part of the Ratio Group Club was Jack Good, who'd worked on the top secret code cracking project at Bletchley Park during the war. Another member was Rosh Ashby, and he is regarded as one of the most influential pioneers of cybernetics and system science, and wrote a very influential book called Design for a Brain in 1952. He also created a homeostat machine, and you can see that here. Now, this is a system that could respond in changes to conditions and maintain its own stability. So this homeostat machine of 1948 is the earliest device to be created that had the capacity of adapting to its own environment. And you can see here it was made from four repurposed RAF bomb control units that could respond in changes. They were filled with water, and the machine was designed to automatically adapt its configuration to stabilize the effects of any kind of disturbance that you might introduce into the system. Now, this captured the imagination, public imagination, scientific community imagination, as you might imagine, like Noah. And Time magazine described this as the closest thing to a synthetic brain so far designed by man. Someone else who was a member of the Ratio Group was William Gray Walter, and he created some of the first electronic autonomous robots. Now, these were used as a tool to study ideas about brain function. And they were three-wheeled, light-following tortoises. They were called tortoises because of their shape and the sort of slow rate of movement that they made around the floor. And also, they taught us about the secrets of organization and life. And here you can see them exhibited at the Festival of Britain in 1951. Many other members of the Ratio Club we don't have time to go into today, but a very influential group. So it was in this atmosphere of enormous energy and optimism that pervaded post-war Britain as it began to rebuild that these people were hungry to push science in new and important directions. And cybernetics rapidly developed from a specialist term, meaning a specific scientific field of study, to become more of a household word that covered a whole gamut of expectations about the future in the 1950s. And this is particularly within the art world. Now, cybernetics began to impact the visual arts from about the mid-50s onwards. And it is noteworthy that the artists who began to investigate it came from a constructivist or Bauhaus-influenced background. And among the first artists in Britain to consider the implications of science, new technology, and the mass media for art and society were the Independent Group. And here you can see some of the members here in the mid-50s. The Independent Group was a loose gathering of young artists, designers, architects, theorists, centered around the Institute of Contemporary Art in London, the ICA. And they were inspired by a wide range of subjects, including scientific developments and popular and American culture. Members included Richard Hamilton, Eduardo Paolozzi, who you can see here, Nigel Henderson, also pictured here, William Turnbull, Lawrence Alloway, Rainer Banham, the Smithsons, Allison and Peter Smithson, and others. And they represented a cross-section of the visual arts and design, theory, and criticism. And many of these people had become familiar with technology during wartime. They worked with technology during the war. The Independent Group generally believed that visual culture did not exist in a vacuum. Instead, it was informed in direct relation to science and technology. But we must remember that this was not an obvious approach to art practice at this time. They were actually very avant-garde in their way of thinking. And for example, the British cybernetics expert E.W. Mayer was invited to the group to talk about a lecture called Probability and Information Theory and Their Application to the Visual Arts. And this was in 1955. And this resulted in one of the members, John McHale, whose work you can see here, producing a whole series of collages based on the theme of the transistor. Now, transistor had just recently been invented at this time and had revolutionized communications. So the one you can see here on the left, is from the Tate Gallery from 1954. And then there's another one which he made in America. So he actually reassembled materials that he cut out of magazines and mass media to create these new technological automata creatures. McHale actually said, and I quote here, they are out of Frankenstein by way of IBM. And then later, a couple years after this, he went to the US on a Yale University scholarship to study under Joseph Albers, the ex-Bauhaus master. And that Machine Made America Too on the right-hand side there, that one dates from that period when he was in the States. Too hard to hear. Is that better? Okay. Now, John McHale and Richard Hamilton both were interested in machines, mechanisms, and ready-made articles. And in this, they were partly inspired by Siegfried Gideon, who wrote a book in 1948 called Mechanization Takes Command. Now, Gideon suggested, and I quote, artists should resort to elements such as machines, mechanisms, and ready-made articles such as some of the few true products of the period to liberate themselves from the ruling taste. So here we see the beginnings of what might be called a human-machine interface in art. And this resulted in Richard Hamilton's Man, Machine, and Motion exhibition of 1955, which was all about this, the synergy of human and machine. Now the catalog to this exhibition states, the relation between man and machine is a kind of union. The two act together like a single creature. Well, the show contained approximately 220 mainly photographic documents from all periods of history, illustrating the technical evolution of all human mobility. So here we have imagery from space. You can see there's a spaceman in a suit there, sort of to the right. I'm gonna get my deep sea diver. Underwater. Spacemen are here. Deep sea divers, underwater machines. Also, air was involved with a glider, and then there's some air at the back, and land. So he had space, air, land, and sea. And the way that the human and machine worked in synergy together. Now, this was a very unusual display at the time, and a cross-disciplinary way of thinking using non-art imagery. These are all found images taken from mass media. Hamilton's long-standing interest in science went back to the exhibition Growth and Form of 1951, which was the ICA's contribution to the Festival of Britain. And in this, he was inspired by the biological scientist Darcy Wentworth Thompson in his book of the very similar name, On Growth and Form. Now, Darcy Wentworth Thompson looked at the way things grow and the shapes they take. This is the study of morphogenesis. And this was highly influential in the art world, even inspiring artists to this day. And Hamilton's exhibition, you can see on the right-hand side there, was an attempt to bring the arts and sciences together with the aim of demonstrating what they might have in common. And again, he's presenting imagery which is non-traditional art imagery. So this is scientific imagery presented as an aesthetic experience. So he's got pictures of microscopic life forms. He had on view some bones and some x-rays. And indeed, the display itself was unusual at the time. It was groundbreaking. It was almost an immersive environment. You could walk through this exhibition in amongst these different displays, very different from a traditional gallery display of works hanging on a wall around four rooms of a room. So both of these shows were revolutionary new concepts not really seen before in the art world. And they were the first of a series of landmark exhibitions bringing together the arts and sciences, several of which were staged at the ICA right through to 1968. But of particular relevance for the birth of computer art is the show This Is Tomorrow at the Whitechapel in 1956. And this was a collaborative exhibition by the independent group. Now, one of the key themes of this show was design and communication and the breaking down of traditional divisions in the arts, which the artists believed, and I'm quoting from the catalog here, they believed limited their efficiency and made collaboration difficult. So if you kept the traditional boundaries in art, it limited efficiency and made collaboration difficult. So we needed to break down traditional barriers in the arts, the traditional divisions, sculpture, painting, architecture. There could be a bit more fluidity in what art actually is or was. Now, within this exhibition, the catalog you can see on the right-hand side there, is a very major step forward in British art. And this is the very first time that a published reference to the use of a computer with regard to art making is ever published in the UK. So this is 1956, the This Is Tomorrow catalog. I've got a little one here. And what the artists have done, and you can see this is section 12 of the catalog, is present a chart detailing potential tools and methods of practice. So I don't hope you can read, but it's as well as traditional things like fingers at the top, arranged in or on hands, operated or produced by the body. We also have further down things like punched paper tape, magnetic surfaces, wire tape and discs, counter wheels, arranged in or on, desk calculating machines, punched card machines, machinery, operated or produced by, motor and input instructions. So here we have the key to the new way that these artists are thinking about art production. And a few pages later, they reference the author Edmund C. Berkeley and the concept of a giant brain, or machine as a giant brain. Well, Berkeley was an American who published a popular book called Giant Brains or Machines That Think in 1949. And this book used very clear language. It was set out for non-specialists. And it's really both a primer and a manifesto. And in it, Berkeley describes concepts such as binary, what binary is, what input and output are. And here you can see a bit of publicity material, which I love, from this book produced by Wiley Publishers. Glimpse your future in giant brains or machines that think. And he also asked lots of interesting questions like, can machines think? So this emphasized the futuristic aspect of this subject. And there's a wonderful visual on this book of a head, a brain, tapped into some kind of machine there. Straight into the brain. So this really captured people's imaginations, and it appears to have been the reference point for the independent group. Because here's Edmund C. Berkeley on the left-hand side, and he is publishing a chart which is very similar to the one, the independent group. So we have physical objects, electronic tubes, arranged in or on machinery, operator produced by motor and input instructions. And then he's got a checklist of various things as to whether it's low cost or takes up much space. Is it permanent? Is it erasable? Is it versatile? So at the top, he's got nerve cells arranged in or on the human brain, operator produced by the body. And it is not very low cost, but it doesn't take up very much space. So it's very, seems kind of amusing to us today. But you can see how for a layperson, this was very inspiring for an artist to consider this type of technology. Actually, I've got a close-up of that slide, I think. I'm going the wrong way. Oh, there we are. Oh, here we are. This is much better. Okay, here we can see much better. So here's his little checklist. Electrostatic storage tubes, machinery, motor and input instructions, punched paper cards and paper tape, exactly similar to the independent group here, who were very inspired by this. Well, in 1953, Hamilton went on to teach at King's College Durham University at the city of Newcastle upon Tyne. And together with Victor Passmore, he set up and ran a basic design course, which is a new type of art education in Britain. Now, basic design built upon the Bauhaus concept of an integrated method of teaching to train artists and craftspeople to participate in the expanding industrial society. And it placed emphasis on learning through experimentation and focused on the student rather than the curriculum, and on the learning process rather than the results. It also focused on the value of group enterprise rather than individual endeavor. Now, there had been courses of basic design before at Camberwell School of Arts and Crafts and at the Central School of Arts and Crafts, and several independent group members taught on those courses. But at King's College Newcastle under Hamilton, and Passmore, this was the most radical and progressive art education available in Britain at this time. So we are starting to get a sense of process as being as important, if not more important, than object, and ideas like cooperation entering the art conversation. Now, basic design in Britain was also a crucial component of the development of abstraction here. Victor Passmore had moved from an impressionistic, figurative style to pure abstraction based on the principles of constructivism, and was by this time one of the leading art abstract painters in Britain. And he believed, and here I quote, that a modern basic course should assume a relative outlook in which only the beginning is defined and not the end. And here you can see he is at work on a mural for the Festival of Britain. Here are some of Richard Hamilton's lecture slides. And he has got, on the right-hand side, you can see an advertisement for Ford motor cars and an airplane glider. So he's really saying that modern advertising has myths and fantasies as vital as any in history. And again, we're seeing part of the fusion of human and machine and the formulation of a new mythology of what might be called the technological superhuman. This fed very much into his man-machine motion show, which included input from his students and opened at the Hatton Gallery in Newcastle before moving down to the ICA. Here's some student work from this period. Again, this was a unique concept in British education at this time. No more copying from plaster casts. No more studying the old masters. This is what had dominated art education since the founding of the Royal Academy. Basic design attempted to take into account the revolutionary developments of modern art, including American abstract expressionism, as well as popular culture, advertising, movies, etc. And these works here are students' exercises in media dexterity. Now, the influence of cybernetics spread to other art schools and eventually into polytechnics as the students themselves went on to teach. For example, we have the student of Richard Hamilton's basic course, seen here, Roy Ascott. Now, Roy Ascott is a very important person in the history of cybernetic art in Britain. And he was influenced by the radar technology he encountered during his national service in the RAF, and he was inspired by Passmore's constructivism. He incorporated an interactive element into his work that reflected his interest in communications and the theory of cybernetics. He believed, and I quote, "We are moving towards a fully cybernated society where processes of retroaction, instant communication, and automatic flexibility will inform every aspect of our environment." And this has come to be very much true, as we know in our present day. So here you can see some of his change paintings. Now, he took something here of Jackson Pollock's gestural painting and arrived at the idea that Pollock's paintings contain a visual metaphor for networks. So he was influenced in this by the big Pollock retrospective in 1958 at the Whitechapel. But understood in the light of cybernetics, this is a work of art as a system, which includes the painter, the creator, and the viewer, the participant. So Roy Ascott said, if you get six of these basic seeds, elements from Jackson Pollock's gestural painting, and paint them on transparent sheets and put them in a runner, they could slide back and forth, one behind the other. And that's really what you're doing in painting, except that you aren't doing it. You're getting the viewer to do it. The viewer can make their own pictures. So that's what you see here, is there's actually a viewer down in that lower slide moving the Perspex panels with the different images on them back and forth so that you get a change that the viewer can participate in. It's a kind of relationship with the audience in a practical way that wasn't seen in abstract expressionism. Now, in 1961, Ascott went to Ealing Art School, and there he created an extraordinary new type of second-generation basic course, which he named the Ground Course, to emphasize learning from the ground up. And this was among the first of the new foundation courses. Foundation courses were brought about by the Coldstream, as a result of the Coldstream Report of 1960. And this was part of the radical reform of the whole of the art and design sector at this time. In fact, these foundation courses remain an integral part of British art education to this day. Well, Ascott's course was revolutionary. He was trying to better equip his students for a cybernetic world, which was becoming, to a large extent, automated, and where human perception was mediated through a range of mechanisms. The construction of change was his first substantial reflection on the importance of cybernetics to his own creative process, and by extension, as a basis for the ground course itself. And here you can see he says, cybernetics is concerned with what things do and how they do them, and with the process within which they behave. It takes a dynamic view of life, not unlike that of the artist. Control and communication in animal and machine is a proper study for the artist. Well, in the studio on the ground course, there was no timetable, no official timetable. It was a radical way of working. Ascott developed a way of teaching that was not based on the traditional master and apprentice system. Instead, he made behavior and process the model for the course. The tutors set the students projects using analog devices, such as calibrators for selecting human characteristics and behavioral alterations, in a random but systematic manner, as seen here. And you could construct your own exercise by choosing the parameters. So this is a physical dial that exists made out of paper, cardboard, and you can move the different wheels around and select different characteristics through which you can then use as a system for making a piece of art with. You could construct your own exercise by setting the parameters for what you wanted to do. And mind maps were another thing that they used, analog device that they used, exercises in analysis and behavior again. So Ascott is here teaching cooperation and interdependence. And such devices were used as part of a computational way of thinking because, of course, they did not have access to computers at this date. Well, important figures of the day taught at Ealing, including Harold and Bernard Cohen and the American Ron Katai and many others. And Ascott also brought in guest lecturers, including Gustav Metzger, the inventor of autodestructive art. And this is artwork with the capacity to destroy itself after a finite existence. And here you can see Metzger performing one of his acid action painting events in London in 61, where he sprayed three large nylon sheets with hydrochloric acid, so that they began to disintegrate in seconds and in about 20 minutes, there's nothing left but just the ragged remains. Well, Metzger later on produced the Destruction Art Symposium in 66, and this attracted famous artists, including Yoko Ono, who did her cut piece there. I don't know if any of you know that work, very famous now. Well, Metzger was one of the first artists to actually detail the specific use of a computer in relation to his practice. And here you have a sheet showing a number of his manifestos. His 1961 manifesto declared his interest in computer-controlled cybernetic systems. He wrote, "The immediate objective is the creation, with the aid of computers, of works of art whose movements are programmed and include self-regulation." Now, Metzger realized that computers had amazing potential, although his interest in them was primarily as metaphors. He did work for many years on his massive proposal, Five Screens with Computer, and you can see it here in the Cybernetic Serendipity catalog, although he's only done a drawing with four of the screens. But this was a computer-controlled environmental, a big environmental work, massive work, which again would degrade over a period of time, in this case 10 years. And it was made up of giant walls that ejected elements out of them, and you can see his drawing for it. It was also interactive. People living nearby could influence the destruction. He wrote, "The spectator, by means of electronic devices, can have a direct bearing on the action of these works." Sounds very much like something you might get today, doesn't it? However, this was unrealized due to costs. It was massive and way too expensive to ever be realized, but very interesting as a proposal. Metzger's talk at Ealing Art School was extremely influential upon the students and staff, and it encouraged Ealing College student Pete Townsend of the band The Who to later invent autodestructive rock, where he smashed his guitars on the stage in the 70s. Another visitor to Ealing was the cybernetician Gordon Pask, a member of the British Cybernetic School. And he was concerned with the role that computers and new information technologies could play in making a positive contribution to our lives. And as a student at Cambridge, Pask had actually met Norbert Wiener. Here he is, here is his early Musicolor machine. And this is probably the first cybernetically inspired performance system in the UK. So this is a machine that he built himself, and it really crosses the fields of art, music, performance, and science. In fact, my colleague Nick Lambert has written, "As an example of an early piece of interactive art, it was so far ahead of its time that the vocabulary to describe it really doesn't exist. It was very interactive. The performer could play the machine, and light and sound emanated from it." So it was a true joint product of human-machine interchange. The human performer didn't control the performance, nor did the machine. They worked together in synergy. And in 1964, Pask gave a lecture at Ealing on systems theory and cybernetics, and this had a major impact on both staff and students. So the 60s were a time of major revolution in the arts, and many traditional critical frameworks were being questioned, undermined, and replaced. And there was a pervasive sense of failure that somehow or other the great achievements of European art, which many had previously assumed to be the pinnacle of human culture, had counted for nothing when the great social catastrophe of the war had unfolded. So people were questioning, you know, perhaps the art world has been fatally separated from the society that it sought to represent and serve. And into this debate came the technological optimism of the cybernetic school. So after Pask's talk, another of the teachers at Ealing, Noel Forster, designed this diagram that you can see here, and this is just part of it, a statement of intention, and this was for an exhibition that Roy Ascott held in London. And it detailed the interrelated nature of many of the cybernetic ideas around at the time. So we can have things like, you can see up there, society as an organism, and requiring a vigilant inspection and a viable program for planning of all points. Adaptive control is required to make stable our society. And then all of these different things feed into a contingent environment. And then there is feedback from various other systems going on. So this is a kind of statement of intent of how a person could consider new forms of art. Well, Ascott later moved to Ipswich Civic College from 1964, and he became head of fine art there, and he constructed a similar type of course to his ground course. And for a very brief time, Ipswich Civic College became a hotbed of experimental art. One of the students was Brian Eno, whom you can see here in the studio. So Ascott's important contribution to art education can be traced through the following generation. Also teaching at Ipswich during the middle 60s was Stroud Cornock, a Royal College of Art trained sculptor. And here you can see him in the studio with some of his students. He's actually on the far right there, wearing a big calibrator type device around his neck. Again, an analog device that you would rotate and select different behavioral characteristics, and then you could act out an experimental piece of art with it. Well, later, in the late 60s, Cornock moved to the city of Leicester Polytechnic, where he founded a media handling course. And the main principle of this course being that a belief in any medium was valid for artistic activity. And at Leicester during this time was also Ernest Edmonds, who we'll hear from later. Stephen Willits was one of the students on Roy Ascott's original ground course at Ealing, and he subsequently went on to teach at Ipswich. Now, Willits realized that the audience is as important as the artist in creating meaning in the artwork. And this is very different from the prevailing model of this time, which held that the artist is a solitary, creative individual, isolated from the rest of the real world, not participating in the market economy, you know, the ivory tower argument. But Willits said that it's completely wrong, and his early student work, manifestos, that he gave out at gallery openings in the West End very much reflect his thinking at this time. So here we can see the realization of the potential of the conceptual model and its field of behavior proposed by the artist is cognition. And then we also have, and these were typed, by the way, on pieces of paper and handed out to passers-by at gallery openings, which must have been very radical in 1961. Also, we have a page from his notebook you can see here where he's got the artist and their environment and feedback from the environment in a circular sort of going around as a system. How can artwork genuinely involve genuine participation so that the interaction would be a more dynamic exchange between artist and audience? And Willits' practice used cybernetics as a way, a model, a mode of questioning how art could function in society. Much of his work takes the form of diagrammatic drawings and conceptual models. And this shifts the focus from the art object to the audience. And again, he was inspired here by Ross Ashby and Gordon Pask. And Willits became a pioneer of conceptual art, and especially of socially engaged housing projects from the 1970s. But before we see that slide, I'm just going to mention this. Here we have a design, a diagram for a proposal for what a work of art could be as a model. The observer works within a given restriction by the object. The observer creates from his own space with object. He is given a random situation from which he produces his own order. So again, it's about an interactive way of thinking about art. Well, as I said, he started working with socially engaged projects from the 1970s, working interactively with audiences, especially in public housing estates. And he produced very many writings, and here are just two of his books that give you an idea of the sort of thing he was thinking about. Many of these ideas came together in the mid-70s with his work Metafilter, which was an interactive work involving two participants mediating through a machine, responding to questions, attempting to reach a state of agreement. Well, the great interest in cybernetics and art in Britain culminated in the exhibition Cybernetic Serendipity at the ICA in 1968, curated by Yasha Reichardt. And this was the first gallery show of its type, and certainly the first of its kind in Britain. And it drew together leading artists from around the world. In fact, there were 325 participants, covered a wide range of disciplines, including painting, plotter drawings, dance, music, animation, poetry, film, performance, sculpture. And a scaled-down version was even toured to the Corcoran Gallery in Washington, D.C., and also to the Exploratorium in San Francisco, and on to Japan. And here's an installation view of it. You can see on the left-hand side, that's a cybernetic sculpture by Nicholas Schoeffer, a European artist. And on the far right, you can just make out the edge there, that big round form of one of Gordon Pask's works. And this is the Colloquy of Mobiles. And here's a better view of it hanging from the ceiling. These were five robotic-like figures mounted onto the ceiling. And there were two males, they're the ones in the middle, and then three females around the outside edge. And they communicated with each other using light and sound. And members of the public could also interact with these using mirrors and torches and flashing lights at them. So this was an exploration of machine-to-machine and person-to-machine communication. And it was probably the first of its kind in the sense of it being interactive, immersive environment that you could walk around it in and through. Recently, the colloquy of mobiles has been recreated by the College of Creative Studies in Detroit, and they've remade the entire piece and have put modern software behind it. And here you can see it on view currently. It's at the ZKM Museum in Germany, and people can interact with it. Well, one of the aims of Cybernetic Serendipity was to show the scope of what was possible, emphasizing the optimistic and celebratory nature of the undertaking. And it was an enormously influential exhibition upon what might be termed the second generation computer art pioneers who saw this as young people. And in the wake of Cybernetic Serendipity, a whole new creative world started opening up, and including, of course, the creation of the Computer Arts Society, which was a group of like-minded practitioners, first mooted in 1968 and officially founded in 1969 with the exhibition Event One, and you're looking at the poster of that here. This was an interdisciplinary exhibition and workshop, and you can see the different types of artworks that were undertaken there. It was also the first time that a computer entered the Royal College of Art, and members used this machine to make work during the weekend. And this machine was borrowed from Imperial College. Well, this new creative world that was opening up for artists was helped by advancements in technology. Computers became less bulky and slightly less expensive as the 60s progressed and into the 1970s. And here you can see the co-founder of John Lansdowne on a teletype in 1969. And he is using this teletype system, which is an easier method of getting your instructions into the computer without having to use punched cards on the mainframe. Lansdowne was an architect by profession, and he also had an interest in computer choreographed dance, and he became a pioneer in producing computer-generated notations for dance positions. And that's what you see here with some students from the Royal Ballet School, and they're holding printout of different types of Laban dance notations so that they could then construct a performance from it. Well, all of this excited Gustav Metzger, who again became an early member of the Computer Art Society, to write, if 500 artists were now to enter computer art, they would find it difficult to exhaust the technical and aesthetic possibility of the existing mechanisms. Well, we certainly have a lot more than 500 artists using computers nowadays, don't we? And it's still not exhausted. Well, books began to be published, and all of these were very influential at the time. There you can see Cybernetics, Art and Ideas by Yasha Reichart, which was a couple years after Cybernetic Serendipity, and a little book produced by the World of Art, Thames and Hudson. However, at this time, of course, computers were still elaborate, complex machines, and gaining access for artists was a major hurdle that had to be overcome. Many artists had to learn to write code themselves, as we saw Lansdowne doing in the previous pictures, or to cultivate a relationship with a technician with whom they could collaborate and actually access the equipment. And such relationships were helped by the creation of the polytechnics towards the end of the 1960s. Now, polytechnics were combinations of hitherto separate colleges of art and colleges of technology. And they were gathered together under one umbrella organization. One administration took charge of a number of different disciplines, which again was very new. And of course, this was particularly important for the early days of computer arts activity because it meant that people from different disciplines could cooperate more easily. So artists could have the chance to access computer systems, which usually belonged to the math department. And this is what happened at Lanchester Polytechnic in Coventry, which you can see here. These are some stills from a film by Clive Richards, who was a graphic designer. And he met Ron Johnson, who was a computer programmer, who said to him, I have a machine that can draw. Well, that's very exciting if you're a graphic designer in 1969, 1970. And this resulted in Spinning Gazebo, which was a film, the very first computer animated film created in a British art school. And this polytechnic later became Coventry University. In fact, art schools became incubators of computer arts during the 70s. And at the Slade School of Art, a pioneering computer art curriculum was established in 1974 by the systems artist Malcolm Hughes. And this was a studio setup with computing equipment, much of which the artists in the department constructed themselves. And here you can see Dominic Borm in the late 70s working on a teletype. And to the right of that is a little green screen where he can do some previewing. And on this side, on the left-hand side, is a flatbed plotter where you could actually output your drawings. The Slade in the 70s became a hotbed of activity in the UK, particularly for artists interested in generative forms and cellular autonomy. Well, this research was published by me in 2008, and recently this book has been reissued as an ebook with some slight updates, and you can find that online. And you can also follow me on Instagram, where I post occasional snippets of British history from this time. So I thank you very much, and we are now going to invite Professor Ernest Edmonds to join us and tell us all about the polytechnic culture and what it was like to actually make art as an artist during these times. Thank you. You want to start or you want to introduce?
I've introduced you already, so I think...
We can start.
Yeah.
All right, lovely. Well, welcome to this. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here. Now, I want to start off because you actually saw... Can we hear all right?
We're just going to get slightly closer.
We're going to get slightly closer. This needs to come closer to me.
Yeah. I'm going to ask you to gently sweep your hair behind your right shoulder.
Is that just for appearance, or is
it? It's got to look good as well.
So we need this direction. Great. Thank you very much. Okay, good. You actually saw Cybernetic Serendipity, Ernest.
I did. I went several times, as a matter of fact.
Can you tell us a little bit about how you found it, and how did you start making art inspired by Cybernetics in the early days? What did it mean to you, Cybernetics?
Well, I was interested in cybernetics, as so many people were at this time, separate from art. It was an important new subject, and we read about it. We were interested in following it and so on and so forth. And of course, I went to the ICA to see this exhibition, which was inspiring and fascinating. It contained some very interesting art, but it contained some very interesting technology also, and some very interesting challenges, right. And so it was an exhibition from which lots of things ideas could grow. This was really the point. It wasn't just a show of some nice art, right? It was quite different.
It was very stimulating. Things like this hadn't been seen before, had they?
Yeah.
They weren't typical that
no,
you would see
not
at the
at all.
ICA.
But my specific start was that I was working at the City of Leicester Polytechnic, and I was making my art. I've been making art for a very long time. Well, not a very long time, I was only in my 20s, but anyway, for quite a long time. And I was making a multi-piece art piece, relief, mm-hmm. which I was having difficulty with. I was having difficulty making it arranged the way I wanted it.
Now this is what became 19.
It's
called
what
19.
Became 19.
And I think we can see. We can't see it. I'm sorry.
No.
I apologize.
Well, I'll mention. Yeah, there is something there which I'll mention in a moment. I have lived lots of parallel lives, and one of them was in logic, right? So I did a PhD in mathematical logic, and I had a problem in logic, and I found a way of solving it by writing a computer program.
Right.
Right, I wrote a computer program which gave me an answer. I published the paper in the Journal of Symbolic Logic. I didn't have to mention computers because I got the answer that way, and you didn't have to say how you got the answer, just that it was correct. And then I realized that this problem I was having with my art was very similar. So I thought, well, hey, I know how to deal with this. So I wrote a program.
Yes.
And in fact, there's a bit of the program in the middle there.
Okay.
I should add something because I think Polytechnic, the City of Leicester Polytechnic,
yes.
was very advanced because it had a computer.
Yes.
It had a computer. Uh-huh. The whole institution had one computer. And only a tiny bit of it would fit in this room.
Mm.
It had to fit in a much, much bigger room than this. Probably the whole floor of this building, roughly speaking, air conditioned, people in general not being allowed in there and so on.
It was looked after by technicians.
And the computer could only do one thing at a time. I was very persuasive, it turns out. And they gave me a 3-hour slot. And if you think about that, what it meant was I had the complete university computer resource available to me for 3 hours. Right? Think what that would mean today. To run this program to try to solve my problem for my artwork. Fortunately, I was an intelligent computer programmer. I taught myself to program the year before, so you know, that was pretty good in those days.
Well, that's been true very well, so I'm going to switch you.
I taught myself to program carefully. And so, what I did was, as my program was looking for a solution, if it got anywhere near, I got it to print it out on paper and then go on and try and do better and better. The truth was, in 3 hours, my program never found a solution. But it got quite close. And just on this side here, you can see there are two of the solutions that it got that were near solutions. And the pencil marks are what I saw that if I changed those three round, that was the solution. So a little bit of human addition to the computer's power, and we were there, right?
Yes.
And so I had used a computer to make a relief slightly in the systems art tradition.
Yeah, a physical object.
A physical object.
You hung on the wall.
Physical object.
Yeah, sculptural.
Stroud Cornock, you've already heard the mention of. Well, this artwork, I wanted to spray it, and I wanted to spray it with high quality paint and so on. So I wandered over to the art department and said, do you have a spray booth here? And I found someone who ran the spray booth, and that was Stroud Cornock. Okay, he was interested in all kinds of media, including spray guns and using that kind of paint. So he helped me like that, and of course we got talking and became friends. And when he realized that I'd used a computer program, he got very interested because of the history that Catherine has already told you about his thing.
So this was one of the newly formed polytechnics, the City of Leicester, and this was only one of a handful of centres around the UK at this time that had people who were interested in doing this kind of work. So you're saying that because of this polytechnic structure, you were able to meet someone like Stroud Cornock.
Exactly. So, I mean, the great thing about it was this mixture of subjects, not just like a traditional university, which was really much more limited in its range. But we had architecture, we had fine art, we had graphic design,
yeah,
all on the same camp, and computer science, and so on. Yeah. And I was able to walk around all of that. I, for reasons that we'll skip, because it was complete accident, I became a lecturer in computing. And I thought, how do I make my job interesting? Well, I need to do stuff with art, because that's what I'm really interested in. Mm. And I could just walk across to the next building. Right.
Fantastic. That's quite radical at the time.
It was, and would have been impossible in the university that I'd studied in before, which was Leicester University, because it didn't have any of those departments.
No, no. So this is why this type of art becomes quite interdisciplinary.
Yes. And the whole being interdisciplinary was central. I was interdisciplinary personally.
Yes, so you were suited to it.
And the environment in which I was working was interdisciplinary. And this was crucial. And Stroud and I, in fact, set up a group within the university which was very deliberately interdisciplinary in order to explore and discuss the future.
And the future, you saw the future as being something that could be enhanced through this type of art production, didn't you? It was a new way of thinking about behavior and the way that the mind works and the way that interactivity could work that would be different and would have potential for the future in art.
I mean, we thought that artists should engage with the present and the future, as it were, should engage at the cutting edge of society.
Yeah.
And as you heard in Catherine's talk before, cybernetics, interaction, and so on were things at the cutting edge of society. And we saw those as very much the things that we should engage with as artists, and did.
And did, yes. So tell us about a couple of those projects that you actually engaged with. There was an important one, I think, was it the first one, Data Pack of 1969?
Okay.
Or a very early one?
Yeah, so, well, Stroud and I wrote a paper which is eventually, which we presented at a conference in 1970, and was then published in the journal Leonardo a couple of years later, where it was essentially a manifesto. And to give a sort of one sentence view of it, we said the future of art was in interaction, roughly speaking.
Yes.
There's a little bit more to it than that.
You're still using interaction to this day.
Yeah, and still doing it to this day. And this was a series of talks at this conference organized by the Computer Arts Society. And they also had a space in the exhibition that was associated with the conference. And we thought, well, let's put something in the exhibition that illustrates our point.
Yes.
So jointly, we made an interactive artwork, extremely primitive by modern standards, that was running in that show, using a teletype, a graph plotter, and so on, where people could have a conversation with the computer.
I think you can see that here, can't you?
Yeah, that's Stroud and myself working on it up here.
Yeah, and you can see that he is hooked up, and there is the teleprinter.
There's a printer, indeed. And below it, you can see the paper tape, which was used to instruct the computer what to do. and so this was an interactive artwork in the sense that someone would have, in quotes, if I may put it like that, a conversation with the computer through the teletype, and that would drive what was ever drawn out, so it would be individually determined, and they would take away a data pack, which is a drawing and
a
dialogue and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, and completely unique, because every single time
and everyone was unique, yes.
Yeah, and it couldn't be repeated, because each communication exchange that happens is a unique exchange.
So we weren't proud of this as an artwork, but we were proud of it as an illustration of where art could go in the future.
Yeah.
Of course, this was before PCs and whatnot.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we have to say again that we take a lot of this for granted today, but this is the beginnings of this. It's actually not that long ago, isn't there?
No.
Now, there was something called the communications game, which was very important.
Yeah, so a year later, I was following my interest in cybernetics and looking more generally into something called general systems theory and animal and human behavior and so on and so forth. And I got very interested in this and thought I should try to explore this more extensively in my art. And I came up with the idea of making an artwork where the art was in the interaction between people through an electronic system. In fact, through a network. Actually, I was making it the same year that the internet was invented. So we didn't actually have the internet. There was no web or anything like that. But I had a soldering iron, and I could build a network.
Build things.
Yeah. By designing it electronically.
Yes.
Of course, nowadays you wouldn't need to do that, but that's what I did then. Mm. And where people, in my first version of it, six people, could separately and separate from one another interact with this system, where they were in fact interacting with other people.
Yes.
Transformed by the system. So.
And the actual system itself is not the artwork, is it? The artwork happens in the interaction between the people.
The art is in the behavior and the interaction between the people.
As mediated through the technology.
And so this was the start of something that I'm still doing. I mean, I was even working on yesterday a whole stream of work, which is like what you might call networked art, where the core of it is the interaction between people. In remote locations.
Yes, and of course these days it's easy to do because you've got the internet.
Yeah,
and it's taken on a whole new meaning, because when we were all locked down, it was a way that you could communicate with other people overseas and create artworks with them.
Yeah, so in fact I made a piece that was shown a few months ago, where one part of it was in Leicester in the UK and the other part was in the British Pavilion at the Dubai Expo, right? And with the internet, it's easy.
Yeah, it's easy, yeah. All right, now, there was also a big conference that you organized called the Invention of Problems.
Yeah.
And there were actually two of them in subsequent years, in 1970 and 71, held at Leicester.
So this was important. This came out of the idea that Stroud and I had, that interdisciplinary activity was really important and would drive the art forward.
Mm.
And the Invention of Problems, well, the art, the creativity, wasn't concerned with solving well-defined problems. That's easy, you know. In fact, Einstein said, if you can define a problem, then it's easy. You just got to do some maths, okay? The real problem is, defining the problem.
In the first place.
In the first place.
Absolutely.
So this term, the invention of problems, became the leading light of what we wanted to do. And so we brought together people, including Edward Inartovich, you've seen one of his works here, and many other people, Steve Willits and so on, came to Leicester for these two events, also talking with computer scientists who were doing interactive stuff. And we were trying to explore what were the implications of this new technology, what were the implications of this new thinking and this new understanding of psychology that cybernetics implied.
Absolutely. And Stephen Scrivener was a young artist who saw this there.
He did, and
that's inspired him enormously.
Yes, indeed.
He went on to the Slade to do some computational work, and he was among Malcolm Hughes's first cohort that we mentioned there in 1974. We saw Dominic Bourne later on in the late 70s in the studio. And he became
important in this story, didn't he, Steve?
He did.
Later on.
So, two remarks about that. First, about Stephen Scrivener. So, well, an interesting thing happened to me personally, which is in the mid-early 70s, the head of the department that I was in came to me and said, the Science Research Council, which is what it was called in those days, are giving us a research studentship we could allocate to someone. Would you like to take it on and find a student? So I thought, well, can I use this to further my interest in computer-based art and the exploration of computers in art? But I could see this was a bit dodgy because this was like meant to be a Science Research Council thing. So I rang the Science Research Council and said, look, I'm wondering about allocating this studentship to a student who will look at the implications of computers for art. What do you think? And they said, that would be fine, we'd be very happy. So with that ammunition, I then went to my head of department and said that this is what I want to do, and the Science Research Council said it's fine.
Yes, sir.
So he couldn't say no to that, he didn't say no to that. So the next thing I did is I went to talk to Stroud Cornock, and I said, who should I do? Could you recommend anyone? And he said, well, we had a really good student or the year before, who's now at the Slade, called Stephen Scrivener. So why don't we talk to him? I talked to him. Yes.
Great. And then later on, Leicester became an important center for early PhDs under your direction,
didn't it?
Yes.
And significantly, these first doctorates were for technically orientated projects rather than for traditional media like painting.
Now, we need to point out here that prior to this time, as an artist, you could not get a PhD. It didn't exist. So it was only for PhDs were for doctors and different professions, not art.
Art historians, perhaps.
Art historians, perhaps. Yes. All right. But why were the first PhDs? Why were you able to get the first PhDs for artists in Britain out of Leicester?
Well, it was in a way the trick of seeing that there was something you could do that was involved both in pushing the art forward. And as a matter of fact, pushing the technology forward, which was something we knew about in terms of research and PhDs.
Yes, because of the research culture.
Because of the research culture.
Engendered by the polytechnics.
Yes. Now, it wasn't always technology, because another person who did a PhD with me just after Stephen was Susan Tebbe. Now, she used mathematics in her art. She didn't use a computer, but nevertheless, the same principle.
A technologically oriented kind of systematic way of considering.
And so I think that it's worth me adding that the systems artists, Malcolm Hughes was an important member of the systems group, Susan Tebbe was a systems artist, were very important in the influence they had on the thinking. Their work, their systematic work, their use of mathematics, of series, of repetition and so on, was easily brought into this technological world. And so that people like Michael Kidner, Edward Inartovich, and so on, who came into our community through the Slade, were very important in influencing the people writing software like in the early days, people like Stephen Scrivener, for
yes.
example.
Yes, and that you could get a PhD this way with this technologically orientated or systems-driven project because the examining bodies felt that it was easier or there was a way that you could examine it, that you could justify it, because otherwise, how are you going to award a doctorate to somebody who's making a big painting? How do you, because that's more subjective.
Well, we also had another big advantage with the polytechnics, which is we came under the auspices of the CNAA.
Yes.
And the polytechnics were set up to deal with more practical matters
yes.
than the old universities did.
Yes.
Okay, so that all things relating, which had outcomes in the world, were more acceptable in polytechnics, right? And the CNAA, in its wisdom, had a slightly different rule for the submission of a PhD. And it said, and I can't remember the exact words, but it said that the PhD submission may include other material
yeah.
of some kind, okay? This meant it could be an exhibition,
yes.
it could be a painting,
yes.
et cetera, et cetera. And this this is the beginning of the practice-based PhD.
Yes, because initially, before that time, we need to point out that PhDs were written only. So if you're an artist, you're creating something visual, you're creating an object in the world, how are you going to just produce a big body of written, a big book of written, you know? But as you say, there was this way, the governing body, the CNA was the governing body.
So to take my two examples,
yes.
the two people I've mentioned already, so Stephen Scrivener produced some interactive software that his examiners had to interact with
yes.
as part of the examination,
yes.
as well as read a thesis.
Right.
Susan Tebbe mounted an exhibition of her work that the examiner had to go around and look at as well as read the thesis. Okay.
Right, right.
So this was an innovation
it was.
That was available to the polytechnics
yes.
that gave them a big step forward in terms of PhDs in this area.
And you were really an innovator in this, I think, Ernest, because then right. subsequently lots of other colleagues from different universities, different educational establishments, you know, like George Mallon, the Royal College of Art, would come to you and send students to you who wanted to do PhDs, but there wasn't any means to get one.
Well, that particularly happened with the Slade. So we had a very strong relationship with Slade. So Malcolm Hughes, who I see as a very important figure in this thing,
yes.
Couldn't give PhDs because the Slade didn't allow them. They didn't have the rules to do that.
Yeah,
so he would pass yeah. students to me. So we had a sort of
yeah.
arrangement. And sometimes I would use him as an external supervisor
yeah.
or external yeah. examiner or yeah. whatever.
So you yeah. could be an artist signed up at the Slade, but you could get your PhD through the Polytechnic in Leicester. Because the Slade is part of the University of London, and they don't allow PhDs for artists at this point.
And in fact, there are still problems in the University of London with what's allowed.
Is there really?
A PhD.
So it goes, there's a history of that as well. So I think that's very interesting because we were kind of thinking about a thread of through art schools in this session this evening, weren't we? Starting
yes.
and when we saw Richard Hamilton and then we saw Roy Ascott and then we're really getting right down in, and we're now in well into the 1970s with you and your PhD programs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe I could say something else back in time, which is that when I was earlier than we've just been talking about, I was a student at Leicester University. And one of the philosophy lecturers introduced me to the staff of the foundation course, the basic course,
okay.
at the art school, which was run by people who'd been taught
yes.
by Hamilton and Passmore.
Yes, basic design became a phenomenon, and the students went out all over, and for a brief moment, it became the most radical art education in Britain and changed the face of British education, still existing today. The evidence
Indeed.
Of it.
Yeah.
You know, foundation courses are still the rock bone of a British art school education is the foundation course. You do your foundation, then you do 3 years.
And in research, the practice-based PhD is now
a standard
really
thing.
Important.
And lots of people go for it, don't they?
Indeed they are.
Yeah.
And in fact, a handbook has just come out of De Montfort University, which used to be Leicester Polytechnic,
right?
About practice-based research.
Fantastic. And you were an innovator in that. Okay, now what else have we got? Let's talk a little bit about your own work. It does come from a constructivist tradition, and we've mentioned that it incorporates interaction. It also incorporates a lot of color. You're really keen on color, beautiful color. So
could really your work could be seen as a conversation between drawing, painting, computer-based work, and color with the element of interaction?
Yeah, absolutely.
So how do you actually go about, what kind of a system could you use to go about making an interaction between the audience and the art?
Well, that's a big question. So let me just try to pick off some bits of that. First of all, the colour. I mean, what's been important to me is the colour modelling, where the colour modelling relates to the perception of colour. Okay, so a lot of people using computers use red, green, blue specification, which is completely useless because it's got nothing whatsoever to do with how we perceive colour. So you have to find other ways of doing it.
To do it, okay.
Okay, so, and this has meant that one can deal with the sort of things that artists like Albers dealt with computationally, which actually means more subtly.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So,
the computer to sort of fudge it, if you like.
Yeah. So this has become quite an important element of it, and so how you interact with colour can therefore be dealt with by the computer in much more subtle ways, like the colour becoming a little bit lighter, or becoming a little bit closer to the blues, or something like that.
Okay.
And so on. But the point about the other point in your question really is about how do you go about the interaction element. And this is very difficult. Mm. And the reason that I've done a lot of work in my life on human-computer interaction is the truth is we didn't know enough about it, and we still don't. Right? So we can't predict how a human will react. And so a lot of the work of designing human-computer interaction, and in my case particularly interactive art, has to be kind of experimental. Right, you actually have to have people interact with it before you understand what its nature is.
Okay.
And so one thing that has been important is this idea of the design process or the creative process of an artwork needing to include partly finished work interacting with the public.
Okay.
Right. Possibly in a public space, if it's meant to be a public space artwork, in order to find out how they react to it. And when we were working a few years ago in Sydney, Australia, we were lucky enough to get a bit of the space of the Powerhouse Museum in Sydney, which is a very well-visited museum, allocated to my research group, and we called it Beta Space. And Beta Space was curated by us, our research group, and we put interactive artworks in it, but we put interactive artworks in it which were in a beta state. That's to say the artist had made it, had created it, it worked and everything, but they hadn't actually had the public interacting with it. And they could put it in there, and then they could observe it or get people to observe it for them, or they could interview people who interacted with it and find out about it, and then go back into the studio and modify it in various ways so that it met their expectations more
greatly. And that sounds to me like good old-fashioned feedback in cybernetics.
That's exactly what it is. But it's building that into the creative process of making art.
And not afraid to show something that is in process.
So not just working on your own in private in the studio and then saying, now it's all finished, now
it's out
there
to go.
It goes. Because that doesn't work for interactive art. Because we can't predict enough. We don't know enough psychology to predict enough about what that work really is. And the work is embedded in the interaction, not what it looks like.
Now, that's a very important thing that goes back to your idea of the communication game, that the work of art takes place in between the participants who are engaging in it.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Time for questions? Maybe we'll pause there and have a few questions.
Yes, thank you so much. I mean, I think I wanted to say how great it was to have this conversation, follow your talks, is to really have
an actual living artist.
Yeah, a continuum.
Just. Really.
So, I have a lot of questions that relate in some sense to your talk, but also kind of follow through to some of the things that come up in conversation. So while you think of questions, I'll sort of start.
Okay.
One of the things that really struck me, and I think you hinted at it quite a lot in your talk, is the role of the political in this particular moment. Because I think, in some sense, there is this idea of thinking about society as a system, and what, like, this kind of technological optimism, what can you do when you think about society as a system, but also in some sense with autodestructive stuff, but like kind of breaking down political systems as well, right?
Yeah, so I think definitely.
I'd just be really curious to hear your thoughts about what was the role of the political in some of this, in these sort of networks in some sense, and then also, really to hear both of your thoughts on this question.
Well, I think I've got to mention Gustav Metzger here, haven't we really, Ernest? Because Gustav Metzger, for those of you who don't know, he passed away a few years ago, sadly. He was on the Kinder transport from, he was born in Nuremberg, and he was put on the Kinder transport and taken out of Nazi Germany, became a refugee to Britain. And the trauma that he experienced, a large portion of his family was killed subsequently by the Nazi regime. And a large portion of his work has been dealing with the trauma of warfare. Well, where do these computing systems come from? They come largely from weaponry research out of the Second World War. So Gustav was very good in the early days, and here I'm talking like, you know, 60, 61, we saw his autodestructive art, of reminding people that computers, you know, have the potential to be the most totalitarian tools ever used against society. I think that's sort of, he actually used the word totalitarian, didn't he? Reminding people that you know, there's a social responsibility that comes with using this new technology. And of course, in those days, the war and the remembrance of it was much closer to people than we're so far removed from it now, although having said that, we've got some major issues going on in the East. Which we hope we don't have to repeat any of this again. I think that people were, Gustav particularly in his work, was trying, and even to a lesser extent, Stephen Willetts, although not in such an overtly political way, to talk about how can we use these things for good with always the remembrance that they come from weaponry and were invented to control bombs. What would you think about that, Ernest?
Well, of course, that's absolutely right about Gustav, but I think I'd add to that something sort of slightly broader, which is that I think, especially during the 60s, we were all very concerned about this hierarchical view where in some people's minds, the artist was some special person who dictated what was good and handed it down for the benefit of everyone to get something from it.
And there certainly is no interaction or participation involved in that model at all.
Because the artist, you know, knew everything, was a kind of god.
Yeah.
And that was a political position that we were against.
Okay.
And we saw the good side of the computer as giving us a way out of that.
Okay.
Certainly, Stephen Willett's stuff, which was less obvious than
Metzger's,
was in that area.
Yes.
But interactive computing altogether did this. And so the idea that the quality of the interaction, the handing over of some of the creative experience even to the public from the artist, that the artist should be enabling and encouraging creativity in others, was a political position,
that's very important, that's worth knowing. We don't tend to have that idea today, I don't think,
so
much.
But I mean, I think that the idea is here in a conflict in artificial intelligence, right? Because, to be very, very brief on this, but the conflict in artificial intelligence is between those people who think that AI should be used to make things that do clever stuff for humans and instead of humans, to those people who think that it should be used to amplify human creativity, pleasure, and capability.
Yes. Which goes back to your wonderful article, which was the human amplified by the computer.
Oh, yeah. So that
Funnily enough, there it is.
That was the question Stroud and I asked really in 1970.
Yes. It was.
But it's still
very
much
here, isn't it? Yeah, we're still struggling with some of these ideas today.
Yeah, no, thank you. So I have many more questions, but I think we have questions from the audience and also in the room. So I'll...
what we've done is we've switched it so that you're the main mic and I'm going to take yours and your lab.
I can use this, okay, fine.
Okay. Well, talking of interaction, there's lots of people online.
Oh, good.
Really enjoying this conversation from home. But I think the first question actually that we've received from someone called Christopher King at home actually just relates to what you have just said, Ernest, and he asks, would a true, honest application of cybernetic ideas to art practice dismantle the concept slash identity of the artist as produced under capital? And there's a little wink at the end of that question, so a provocation there. And I think you were speaking to that sort of the anti-hierarchy that's sort of embedded in a lot of this ideas and thinking.
But of course, it really should apply to all art. Marcel Duchamp made the point that the artwork doesn't exist until someone looks at it. And he was referring to a static artwork. Okay. Mm. And so we need to reorientate our thinking in this way. And so the same thing applies to this interactive art, only more so, that the artist is still doing something important, but doesn't own everything, and it's not some god who just tells everyone what's wonderful.
I had some questions about lines of influence. So going right back to the first part of your talk with the lovely photograph of the independent group sitting on their Eames chairs,
yes.
and thinking about kind of transatlantic connections and how obviously the Smithsons were friends with the Eames, but some of the systems that processes the kind of the table with the kind of hand, fingers, body.
Yes.
It's very reminiscent of the kind of Eames Studio research processes.
Absolutely.
So what was the kind of lines of influence thinking about that? And then also thinking about going into your question about politics and the kind of work of someone like Elliot Noyes for IBM, the kind of real-time feedback loops, which then, you know, going from this kind of industrial design setting, then kind of moved into a kind of war room setting. Transatlantic influences.
Well, yes, I mean, cybernetics was very much both sides of the Atlantic, and it became, I think I mentioned at some point, I said something like it permeated every aspect of technological thought at the time. You know, thinking persons were very much interested in cybernetics, weren't they, Ernest, at the time?
Sure.
So I think that, yes, there's all these people who are very much interconnected. And we were actually speaking earlier, Ernest and I, and saying that, you know, things were seemed to be a smaller art, it was smaller in those days. You knew more people, and you were introduced to people by other people. Because before the internet, you couldn't just Google something, you know? And so this is why conferences became so important, places where people could meet and exchange ideas. And your colleagues in different universities, different educational institutions were important. So hence, I wanted to really show how it passed from student, from teacher to student. The student went on to teach somewhere else. So these ideas spread out like that. And we take it for granted now that we can communicate with somebody in Australia just like that on the, you know, on the social media instantly. You know, in the 60s and 70s, that was much harder to do. So these lines were very much more important. And I think everybody read the same books, didn't they? And,
sure.
And you know, nowadays there's so many books you couldn't possibly read everything. But you could have more of a body of knowledge was easier to kind of comprehend amongst thinking people. I'm not explaining that very well. What do you think, Ernest?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it was very important, the personal connections and the personal networks, which were quite small and were not limited to any one country necessarily, but of course, geography mattered.
Yes.
You know, because then I remember, for example, talking with an important scientist and he said, I've got to ring off now because I'm expecting a phone call from Chicago.
Yeah.
Because in those days, if you were having a phone call...
It was a big deal.
It was a big deal, you know.
Yeah.
So, which meant that the geography mattered more than it does
now.
Today. But nevertheless, I mean, certainly in what we were doing at the City of Leicester Polytechnic was very much concerned with the network that we had with other people elsewhere. I've mentioned the slide, but of course it wasn't just the slide, but that was important.
Yeah.
And this network of people who knew one another. And this was important also in the sense that we were all kind of on the outside or on the edge of the art world of the day.
Yes, yes.
Okay, good, because we were pushing things forward. We weren't concerned with the Royal Academy.
Or pop art or whatever was the trend.
Or even pop art, no.
Yeah.
No. And so we needed those connections because there was no institutional...
support.
Support for
so
it.
So hence things like the Computer Arts Society, we saw the poster from the Event One exhibition, you know, is a membership organization for people, any like-minded person wanted to join. It was very, very open. There were people in South America, there were people in Japan, there were people all over Europe, there were people in Canada. It had really wide range, and they communicated with a bulletin that was mailed to the post.
I have a follow-up question. Just a quick follow-up in terms of thinking about internationalism and following your thoughts on the transatlantic nature of things. But also, I'm thinking about some sort of work in post-independent India, where, like in the 1950s, this idea, which was coming very much from America at the time, of the kind of democratic potential of technology and how,
yes,
you know, this kind of thinking about society and how communication, especially, and how design schools could really do things, so that like the people like experiments in art and technology,
yes,
working with sort of community groups and so on. And I was just curious, Ernest, about whether at Leicester, were there, did you have much sort of interactions with people coming from elsewhere to do maybe, not PhDs, but were there systems in place, or was there a time when systems started becoming, systems is a bit overused in this context, but
Well, formally, I would say probably not, but informally, mm-hmm, yes. But they were done through personal connections, mm-hmm, and most of us had international personal connections, and they got joined together. Sometimes, interestingly, encouraged by active students who were sometimes really very much part of the development of these networks.
Completely.
More than some of the staff were. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so sometimes the student body was quite important in terms of moving things forward in this particular way.
Yeah, and I remember, just a little bit of side, Yasha Reichart got a letter of introduction to IBM in the US, and she was able to take this and access a whole host of people who were working at everywhere from Bell Telephone Labs, you know, which she could bring back some of the work to put on view. But she had this letter of introduction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, it was quite important then.
Yeah.
Hi. Your talk is was sort of wedded to the history of the British Art School. And a lot has been said in praise of the Polytechnic. Well, I wanted to say a few things that were a little less positive about this, because you mentioned that the Coldstream report in 1960. Sir William Coldstream was director of the Slade School of Art for a long period of time. And you know, it could be suggested that the Diploma in Art and Design, which was the result of his report, series of reports actually, through to the 1970, was influenced British art schools with a kind of Slade way of thinking in all sorts of ways. But one of the thing claims you made when you mentioned Roy Ascott was that the foundation course was an artifact of the Coldstream report, which is not really the case.
It kind of came out of that. I'm
yeah,
just trying to
it came out of the process, and partly it came out of the process precisely because Coldstream was tasked by the Minister of Education with, first of all, the Ministry of Education was fed up with having this centralised system of art awards. So effectively, the Diploma in Art and Design allowed those who were able to run it, those institutions able to run it, relatively autonomous of the central system. Mm. Now, they were not very pleased to give that up, that autonomy, when Polytechnics came along and said, right, we're absorbing all of you lots. Mm. And so there's quite a lot to say, you know, about that process. First of all, the foundation course emerged as much because many colleges of art weren't qualified or equipped to run the diploma.
Yeah, and their students needed
So they needed to do something, so they ran foundation courses.
Yeah.
And then later on, when, I mean, you mentioned the CNAA, but I mean, for example, my lecturer, Ken Rowett at Leeds Polytechnic, they not only did they resist, of course, the business of being absorbed into Polytechnic, and this is also relates to the basic design trend that you were mentioning. But also, they didn't particularly, there's a Guardian article which I have that he wrote, which challenges the notion of art degrees, you know, because the diploma slid into becoming an art degree. And you talked about the sort of top end of the academic process with the PhD, and that was interesting. But I think that this sort of battle really going on, you know, between 69 and 70 involves, for example, at Lanchester, Coventry School of Art, stroke Lanchester, precisely art and language, as you know, were closed down because, why? Because the director of the Polytechnic wrote to the CNA and said, how can you run these courses effectively? When because they don't have any outcome. They're not making any things. So, in a way, the cybernetics kind of got round that. And it's very interesting. I mean, because you're a mathematician, you know that the word machine doesn't necessarily even refer to anything that's actually physical either. It can be just what we would normally think of as an inference, a mathematical process. And you're a logician too, even more interestingly. So anyway, I'll leave it there.
But you're totally right, because I mean, I had to move very quickly, so I apologize because I did move very, very quickly. There's a lot more research here, but you're quite right that that period was full of turmoil and that there were a lot of arguments and discussions going on during this. What kind of art education do we want, and how are we going to do it, and who's going to run it, and what's it going to be like? It was very controversial, a lot of controversy at the time.
So if I could just quickly comment, that I could add to many more negatives to your negatives easily. but it just so happens that in the area of the potential of cybernetics and computing, it happened to work well, or quite well, right? And in fact, not as well as it should have, because art students can still grow up without knowing anything about computers, which is a bit weird in the modern world. It's like, you know, going back 100 years and saying they do a painting course and never touch oil paint. But nevertheless, the round picture is that in the area that we're talking about today, the Polytechnic, with its multidisciplinary capability, did offer benefit. But that isn't to say that everything was great from the art school point of view. Mm. And as I say, I could add many, many negatives to the ones you've just mentioned.
And indeed, not every Polytechnic did this, did it, Ernest?
No.
It was very,
Leicester had one advantage, that of course it was a College of Technology merging with a College of Art. And the principal of the College of Art became the director of the Polytechnic. So we have a slight advantage over some of the other Polytechnics.
Yeah, brilliant. But I mean, there are many Polytechnics you don't see this in any of this. You know, the art person never went down the hall and spoke to the person who was in charge of the computer. It's very rare. We're talking about a small branch of art here, which even to this day, I mean, we could have another session about, we've got issues of marginalization, about being outside of the art world, and there's a whole host of reasons and arguments about why that why that might be. But yeah, we're talking about a small branch. Anyone? I thought there was someone holding up there. Have the microphone.
So this question is what you were saying about how technology comes from. Oh, I guess I'm not speaking into this. Sorry. How it comes from the military and things like that. But and also what you're saying about art as needing to include this interactive process, because I feel very strongly about that. And come from a technology, I guess, background. So, and I see that problem. It's like that's really the main issue with technology, is that it's not including that interactive process. It's almost impossible, really, to do that. And so it's a very similar problem that's happening, you know, on these huge scales. And I was wondering what you see as being, like, ways to kind of solve those problems together, other than education is really the only thing that I can think of as of, you know, common programs for both. But I was just wondering about art as a solution to that, or technology.
Well, Ernest, you set up a whole series of conferences, creativity and cognition,
right.
And some of this was your innovation was to address many of these questions that were just asked, weren't they?
Well, I guess when we talked, it wasn't just me, but anyway, I was very much part of that. When we started that particular series of conferences, which is still going, and if you want to come to Venice in a couple of weeks, that's the latest one. it was set up because some of us found that there were all these people in art talking about technology in meetings, and there was no real expert in technology turning up. And then all these people in AI and technology talking about creativity, and there were no artists invited even, and they were even kind of not wanting them. And we thought this was really a very, very unhealthy situation. So we started this series of conferences which brought these people together. So you've got famous people who'd never even heard of one another because they came from completely different fields.
Yeah.
But I believe this is really important as an activity, not just for the one conference series, but for organizing our educational system and so on, that we really need to bring these things together and not divide things up as systems tend to be, right? Because it's usually at the boundaries or across the boundaries where the excitement is, where the future is.
It is, isn't it? It's in the gap.
Yeah,
in between
those gaps. So if you say, you know, you've got to decide, it used to be, I don't know, but it used to be like in art schools, are you a sculptor or a painter? What a crazy idea that was. You know, but you know, are you a humanities person or a science person? These questions are stupid and very non-productive, and they don't have to be. They don't have to be. There are mechanisms to overcome them. There are funding mechanisms we don't have time to talk about, but...
Yeah. Fascinating.
I think on that note, we have to close for today. Although, I mean, I still have lots of burning questions, and I imagine you do as well. So we're really just moving the conversation to the drinks reception, so we can talk over a glass of wine. Thank you so much for coming, and thank you so much to Catherine.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice and easy.